All right, folks. Thank you for showing up to another episode of Boss Up with Mr. Key. Your host, Andre Key, back at it again. But today we have a special guest. Our guest here, man, when I first met this lady years ago, she was tenacious about investing in real estate and, you know, bought her first property, converted it into a short-term rental, everything from converting vehicles into Toros to investing in multi-unit apartments. And did I mention that she's the CEO of Pearl Tech Corporations? So she's in IT, folks. I mean, my serial partner, serial entrepreneur, Diane M., welcome to the show. I really appreciate you for coming.
Thank you. Thank you so much for hosting me, Andre. For a second there, I didn't think you were actually describing me. I was like, who's he talking about?
Yeah, thanks. Yeah. You got to pat yourself on the back sometime, but I want to make sure I pat you on the back and give you your flowers while I get a chance. But here on our show, you know, it's for the entrepreneur that's out there listening. And I know you are at this point, just like me at one point, reading about other people, wondering how do they do it and figuring out that, man, this person is no smarter than me. I know I can do it if I apply myself. And both of us have collectively at some point decided to do that. And I want people to hear your story. So the next little girl out there that's trying to do it, or a little boy that's trying to make something happen, may hear it and, you know, realize they can do it too. So to start off, I always like to find out where it all began. Like, where did you first wear your first pamper?
Wow. That's interesting. So I was born and raised in Nairobi, Kenya.
Nice.
Several years ago. I'm in my 30s now. And I did wear my first pampers in New York. Because okay. In Kenya, we have different types of diapers or napkins.
So it was no pampers over there.
No.
And just cloths your mom had to wash yes. out. It's too much info, though. That's TMI. Yeah. Great. So you were born in Kenya, and did you go to primary school there?
Yeah, primary and high school.
Wow.
And junior college there.
Oh, wow. Junior college. So mm-hmm. you were basically raised in Kenya.
Yep.
When did you come here in the States?
I came here after junior college, which was about 2 years. I spent 2 years in junior college post high school. I came to the U.S. to pursue university education. Yeah.
Okay. Let's talk a little bit, since you were born and raised in Kenya. Let's talk about that upbringing. Are you like mm-hmm. older sibling, only child?
Yeah, so there's four of us. My mm-hmm. older sister came to the U.S. first, and the idea was for my brother to follow her,
mm-hmm.
But he didn't. He got into a really good medical program in Kenya, and by the time it was my turn, I was in a relationship.
Uh-oh.
The first relationship I was allowed to have since high school.
And allowed like, to have.
Yeah, because I wasn't allowed to date in high school. So when I finished high school, my dad was like, well, you've done well, so you can go ahead and be a grown girl now. So I get into a relationship, and I thought I was in love, and I was told, well, it's time for you to go to the U.S. for your studies. And I was like, well, I can't leave him behind. I tried to avoid that, but they applied on my behalf, and next thing I knew, I was just shipped off.
Whoa. So let me ask you this. Like, you know, your immigrant parents, and were they like very hands on? Like, because here in America, they're like, hey, let him be who he wants to be, whatever. But here it sounds like they were very hands on. I'm like, hey, this is your plan and you're going to follow it if you're going to live under our roof.
Yep. You kind of had to know what you wanted to do by sometime in high school.
Really?
And you were working towards that. So I always wanted to be a lawyer. So I was taking, you know, courses in the arts and history and mm-hmm. political studies and things like that.
Wow, man, a lawyer.
Yeah.
I can see that, but I've never seen you in a courtroom.
Yeah. Thank goodness. It seems to be a bad thing sometimes.
Oh, man. Okay. So, I mean, obviously with that type of structure and, you know, having several siblings, at some point you had to, like, position yourself, have this level of grit and toughness Tell me a little bit about that. Like, what was that like being, you know, were you the middle child, right?
Yeah.
Okay.
So after the school semester was over, we would all congregate in the living room, mm-hmm. and my dad would have our report cards in front of him.
Ooh.
And he would be basically telling us who passed and who had made him proud versus who was going to have to take some extra classes during the break. So,
wow.
I always wanted my dad's approval, so I was, mm-hmm. you know, doing my absolute best. And my other siblings were like, well, school is for fun. So
for fun.
So they were YOLOing and just waiting for the consequences at the end of the semester.
But you're like, nah, I want to be the best. So it shows a little competitive side right there. Yeah. It's like, hey, I don't want to lose. I don't want my dad on my quote unquote ass. Yeah. So good. So you went through that in school. You know, what was school like over there? Were you popular, or were you just like your glasses on, came right home and studied?
Yeah, I'd say it was a mix. In high school, I was popular with mm-hmm. what they want to call the cool kids. I was popular and fun, mm-hmm. but the teachers didn't like me because I didn't have that studious demeanor. They felt like being fun was the opposite of being studious or smart.
Hmm.
But I was making grades. Then when I got to junior college, mm-hmm. I was like, well, you know, I just want to make sure I change this around. I want to make sure the narrative is reversed. So right. I was super studious in junior college, which was the worst mistake ever.
Wow, what? Hold on, tell us about that. Why?
I mean, because junior college was really, really when we're supposed to be having fun. This is post high school. You're just getting ready to go to college.
Mm-hmm.
And, you know, it's kind of that in between. So we're supposed to be socializing, having fun, meeting people of the opposite sex, and just seeing if, you know, you can form relationships. And I was like, nope, don't talk to me. I just want to be in the library so I can impress my dad. So it was so different.
I have a daughter. I need to talk to your dad so I can kind of get some pointers. I want her to be the same way. Junior college, is that associate levels? Is that what that is?
Yeah, so they call it IB in Kenya. It's the International Baccalaureate Program.
Yeah.
It's not so common. It is in some schools in the US, but it's not mm-hmm. so common here. It's common in a lot of the Commonwealth countries. So the UK, Australia, and other countries.
So you get like an international feel for how to communicate and study, et cetera.
Exactly.
So you mentioned, kind of meeting like your first love before mm-hmm. you came here. Just real quick, do you know that guy? Do you talk to him, follow him on Facebook?
Yeah, we are very good friends to this day. He is married with a few kids, but we remain very good friends.
You might have dodged a bullet, huh? I'm just kidding. If you're out there, man, I'm just joking.
That's so funny.
So let's talk about coming here to the U.S. like, and what that experience was like. Was it a culture shock initially?
Absolutely. I mentioned visiting New York when I was younger. A couple of times, my mom was studying for her pharmacy degree in New York. So I would visit her when school was out. Mm-hmm. So I kind of had a feel for the U.S. But mm-hmm. where they took me for college to start out was in Mississippi. So I was living in Memphis. And I honestly did not expect that degree of culture shock. It was like coming from Nairobi, which is the capital of Kenya,
mm-hmm.
Being exposed to a lot of, forward entertainment, fashion, mm-hmm. and all that stuff. And coming to one of the most rural places in the U.S., it was a huge culture shock.
So you're saying in Memphis, they didn't really care about fashion too tough?
Not at all.
They had gold teeth.
They did.
Oh, okay.
And weird rims.
Oh, yeah. It was hard. I mean, I guess it was like a communication barrier, too, to understand what they were saying versus what you were saying.
Yep.
So how long were you there? You got your degree from the University of Memphis?
No, I started out at this college in Mississippi, uh-huh. Rust College, while I was living in Memphis. I transferred to Houston. That's where I graduated, the University of Houston.
What did you graduate in?
Computer information systems.
Oh, how did you go from like wanting to be a lawyer to computer information?
Oh, man. That was so contentious in my family. Uh-oh. So I wanted to be a lawyer. And in Kenya, once you finish high school, you can go straight into law school.
Whoa.
You can also go straight into med school. But in the US, you have to get an undergrad and then go into that specialty. So the problem was my mom didn't believe that there was anything I could study in undergrad that would set me up for a good job while I waited to get into law school or in case I changed my mind. So she thought maybe you should just go into nursing. So just do biology and then go into nursing school. The absolute furthest degree or career from anything I ever wanted to do. But this was like most African parents think the only way to be successful is to be in the healthcare field or legal field. So,
oh, man.
Yeah. So I transitioned. I came here doing biology. I started and I really despised those courses. But I was doing well enough. But as soon as I, you know, got enough strength, I was like, you know what? They're all the way in Africa. What are they going to do if I change? What are they really going to do? Are they going to hop on a flight and come here and whoop me? No. So I just changed my degree to computer science at Ross College and then transitioned to information systems.
Did you hide that from your dad at first?
No, I told them immediately. I was like, I'm transitioning. And they were like, at first they were quiet. And then the results came out and I made mostly A's. And we had a come to Jesus and they were like, okay, we're not going to let you play around with your life anymore. You're making A's because this is just computers. Like, what are you doing? You're just playing around with a computer. That's easy. And so they're yelling at me on the phone and lecturing me. And my younger brother was there to witness it. And he had to keep trying to calm them down because he was like, I understand the vision. I understand what she's going for. And she's actually more passionate about this than biology, so just let her do her thing. She can really turn this into something.
They didn't understand that. What I guess back then, people didn't really know internet. Well, you're not that old. Internet have been around, but
yeah, they didn't understand what types of careers were involved in IT. So they were just like, you're playing around on computers, you're messing around with your education, your future. Well, it's a different story now.
Yeah, now it's like, oh, my daughter, she was so smart.
Yes, you sound like my dad.
You like my little Kenyan accent? I tried to. In college, you obviously had good grades. Mm-hmm. That turning point or key moment was like, hey, don't want to go into biomedical. Like IT is what I want to do. Is there any professors from school that you feel like made an impact that, like, till this day you still remember?
Made an impact not on my decision to transition, but just on being able to stay in school. Dr. Ye, he was the advisor for my program, biology. Mm-hmm. And as foreign students, we're required to maintain a full course load so we can stay in compliance with immigration. So if there were courses that I needed, but they were full, Dr. Ye would always go and talk to the professors and be like, she needs this. She has to get in this class so she doesn't get in trouble with immigration. So that really helped to push me through. And Mr. Smith as well, the registrar, used to take all the excuses from my mom for being late with tuition so I could stay in the course. And he'd be like, my mom would be like, it's okay, don't worry, I'll have it next week. And it would be next week forever. And he's like, okay now. So
it would have been next week for like 2 months.
Yeah.
Cool. So you finished college. I'm sure you graduated pretty high in your class. Yeah. What was after that?
As soon as I finished, I had a job lined up.
Oh, you did interns?
I did. The internships were a factor in being selected for the role. So I worked with GE.
Mm-hmm.
And while I was still in the undergrad program, GE started to interview me. I met them through my sorority. So they interviewed me and they found me to be a fit. And they made me an offer about 5 months before I graduated. And they already set everything up. So the day I graduated, they already had movers come and pack me up and ship my car and ship all my belongings to the new state and get me all set up.
So let me ask, what sorority were you in?
Alpha Kappa Alpha.
So what do you attribute to like GE pursuing you? Was it more the sorority, who you know, or your grades, your GPA, a combination of all of that, or your interviews?
It is a combination of all of that. Okay. I was doing well in school, but nobody could see that. And by being in the sorority and having access to hiring managers through my sorority, mm-hmm. they were able to see what quality I brought to the table.
Ah, so it does impact you, that kind of being those social groups.
It does.
Good, good. So you're working in corporate America. GE, was that who you were working for, right?
Yeah.
Were you working with them when you moved here?
No.
Oh, okay, so you switched a couple of positions, a couple of jobs.
Yeah.
All right, so in corporate America, like, what was that like for you?
It was tough because I, first of all, I was a foreigner, so automatically different culture. Mm-hmm. Even work ethic was very different. In most African countries, and I also speak for Kenya because I'm from Kenya. Mm-hmm. In Kenya, we think about work ethic as being where you're supposed to be and doing what you're supposed to do on time and all that stuff. In America, the corporate culture is more about the in-betweens, the interactions with your coworkers, the after-hours activities.
The social
and things like
side
that.
Of it.
Yeah. And even in meetings, like, I'd be in a meeting room and my natural Kenyan instinct is to just sit and listen and take in as much as I can and only interject if I'm spoken to or if I have anything valuable to contribute.
Right.
Whereas in America, corporate America, you're expected to be visible and vocal. So it was very challenging because sometimes I felt like an imposter. I felt like I'm actually coming out of my natural element to be someone that they want me to be. Yeah. It was very tough.
So after jumping around a few jobs or whatever, like, what was that key moment when you were like, I don't know if I'm made to be an employee? Like, tell me about that time.
It wasn't a key moment. At some point in my career, I felt like I was doing well enough. I was happy with the progress. But I've always been an advocate for multiple streams of income. So I just wanted to get a side gig to bring in additional income. It wasn't like I was like, man, I don't want to work for anyone anymore.
Oh, okay.
But eventually, somebody introduced me to real estate investing, and I was like, there's absolutely no way for me to focus on this aspect and also focus on being someone's employee. So it became a tough balance. And I was like, I think I need to make this decision.
Wow. Now, what did your dad say when you told him that?
So my dad, as well as other folks, have always been just asking, okay, so if you go full-time into entrepreneurship or into real estate, do you have a side? Do you have some guaranteed income? Do you know what your plan is? So that was the only thing. As long as I could show that I had a plan and I was still maintaining my expenses and my growth needs, they were okay. So
You said something key that I like to talk about. Like, a lot of times people want to start a business or go into entrepreneurship, but it takes money to make money. And so if you're not good with, you know, sometimes I tell people you probably have to work a job to fund your business, and you have to be smart with your financing. You know, did you catch on to that quick, or did you have some hiccups with that?
It was very seamless for at the time, my business partner and I, when we started the real estate venture, it was very seamless because we found out during our education, real estate education, that banks were more favorable to W-2s applying for financing. So we decided to do a mix of both. We were like, we're going to do, so one of us is going to do full-time investing. The other one is going to hold on to a W-2 with the intent to plug that money into the ventures.
That was good. That was good that you saw what worked and adjusted and did that. So, I mean, so the first business venture was real estate investment. And what was that place that you bought the first property?
Yep.
I remember your sister. She was shrewd. She was just like, hey, We gotta make sure my sister gets a good place.
Oh, she still is.
She probably got a little reflection of your dad, probably.
Yes, very much so.
So you bought that place. I don't even think you lived in it, but for a month or so.
Yeah, I wasn't really occupying it so much. It was just there as an asset. And the goal was always that when I got married, that would become a full-time rental. Mm-hmm. And then my, you know, husband at the time would, and I would buy more properties and just keep growing that way. So it ended up turning into an Airbnb. And so I still even can go and access it from time to time when I need to stay there. So that served me really well.
Where'd you get your Airbnb education from?
I had a couple of mentors, one of them being Ellie Talks Money. Mm-hmm. She was my very first Airbnb mentor, and she introduced me to another one whose name is Kimoy Martin. So the two of them are super duper knowledgeable. They have Airbnbs all over the world.
Wow. Yeah. Did you have to pay for that mentorship?
I did.
Yeah. Some people, you shouldn't have to pay, but hey, successful people, they don't have time to play. Exactly. So you got to pay to get every, exactly. I say it takes money to make money. And so that's kind of how it is. Was there any point like trying to do Airbnb and like pay for this mentoring program that you felt like money is getting low? Like I need to do something else.
I was fortunate that I didn't have that issue because I've always had multiple streams of income.
There you go. So. You always had that work ethic. Like, hey, I'm going to come show up on time, do what I have to do and get it done. Good. So tell me a little bit. So that started, one was in Austin. Now you got like one in San Antonio, probably in Houston. And then the Toro, like, how'd you decide, like, hey, that's another good business idea?
Yeah, Ellie has been my role model and became a mentor later on. And she talks about all this, like just business ventures and multiple streams of income and turning your liabilities into assets and things like that. So, you know, I saw her with her coming from no car to buying her truck and putting it on Turo. I was like, okay, maybe I can buy that. And then later on, she bought herself a G-Wagon and she bought her mom a G-Wagon and just started giving out tips on how to leverage Turo. So I decided to do that.
So you soaked all this up. Yeah. And to be a business owner, or entrepreneur, it takes a level of courage. Like, were you scared trying to do all this stuff?
I still am. Every venture is new. It looks different. And the business has cycles. It goes through different cycles. Yeah. Right now, the market is tight in almost every aspect. So it's always very scary.
It's important to have some reserves during those times, it right? Is. Yep. It See, is. Again, manage your money. Don't let your money manage you. Yeah. So, man, it's scary. And then so apartment investing. Like, tell us about that one. What made you interested?
Well, when I started investing and doing single family investing, my partner and I were doing so well, considerably well, even during the pandemic and making so much money. And I thought to myself, well, let's take this to the next level. What's after this? What comes next? And found myself venturing into commercial investing. And I started looking at all the different asset classes. Mm-hmm. And just found that for apartments, people always need somewhere to stay.
Yes.
So I figured that was the solid approach. So.
Nice approach. So is there anything after that? Like, are you like looking towards the next venture over the hill?
Yeah.
Oh man, what is that?
So I am. So right now I'm passively investing in apartments in Houston right now. Mm-hmm. I'm looking to become active, which means I would be the one running the whole show, like finding the deal, finding investors into the deal and managing the asset until it brings money back to my investors. Mm. And beyond that, even going into building brand new apartment complexes. Nice. Because if we're in Central Texas, just looking at this market, it's getting saturated pretty fast.
And so, affordable housing too. Yeah. Like, so, but you want to expand probably past Central.
Yeah.
Have you thought about investing in Kenya? Is it worth it for real estate?
I have thought about it. We are my family and I are in the process of building a house right now. Haven't thought about multifamily, although I know people in that space and I know there's opportunity. But right now, my immediate next venture is going to take me to Europe. So later this year, I'm going to be in London and I'm meeting up with some developers to talk to them about what it looks like to.
So you're making these networks like, and I think that's the key. Just like you mentioned, you know, with the sorority, just networks making things move for you in life.
Yeah.
I mean, and you had no fear with that. I guess if you came from like your country to come to America, that takes a lot of courage.
Yeah.
So these other little things that you're doing is like, hey, I'm a little nervous, but like, hey, it's nothing that I can't do.
You hit the nail on the head. I am already so far out of my comfort zone that everything right now is just, it's on the same level. It's on the same, like, what do I have to lose? I'm not at home. I'm so far away from home. I don't have the comfort of my childhood friends. I don't have my parents here to bail me out. Mm-hmm. So it's just, everything is just new. So I'm training through my trauma is what I call it.
Nice. Training through your trauma. I like that. Can I steal that? That's a good one. So just growing and building your empire. What do you see yourself in, let's say, 10 years?
The overall goal, I've always been interested in advocacy, human rights, and that's kind of why I wanted to do law, because I always felt like I had a voice, a louder voice than most people, and there are some people who could benefit from my voice. And so advocacy, philanthropy are like kind of where I'm trying to gear towards. But to get to that point, I want to have financial freedom, time freedom, and location freedom. I have a degree of each of those to some degree, but I want that to be completely 100% free, and I can do whatever I want from wherever I want.
Nice. I was just about to ask you, this is a segment where I throw out a couple of words and I want to know what it means to you.
Okay.
And so the first word, since we're on that, just to give a little more clarity for our viewers, is freedom. What does that mean to you?
Yep. Freedom is not having to wake up, I will wake up, but not having to do it to get a paycheck. Not having to be in a certain place at a certain time to impact whoever I need to impact. So that was time, location, financial freedom, not having to put in extra effort to work. I want my money to make money for me.
Work for you while you sleep, right?
Yeah.
What about fear?
Fear, let's see, what does that mean to me? I would say, I mean, I do experience it a lot. Fear is when things are uncertain, and I think that things might not go the way I want them to go, or I have experienced something negative from doing certain things, and I know I have to do them. Fear usually comes into play during that time. I even though I'm fearful, I still go for it boldly.
You go towards it, right?
Yeah. People always call me bold. So, yeah, that's what comes to mind when I think of that.
And then retirement. What is that to you?
Retirement is not working for anybody to make an income. It doesn't mean that I will just be sitting on my hands doing nothing.
Good.
It just means that I am not clocking into somebody else's clock.
Got it. If you were to, give a piece of advice to a listener or someone, or let's say you're standing in front of an auditorium giving a TED talk, like, what advice would you give to future entrepreneurs out there?
So advice to future entrepreneurs, I would say mindset is really important. So check your limiting beliefs at the door. If you use me as an example, I came from another country, didn't even think I was going to be an entrepreneur. I was not even thinking that. I came here thinking I was going to be a lawyer. but look at the possibilities that opened up when I was open to them. So just look at me as an example. Look at my story and check your own limiting beliefs and go press forward towards your goals.
Nice. I like it. I like it. If you, here's a time where you can plug like any of your businesses, what could they find? Like if they need some, you know, IT consultant, like what, where would they go?
So right now I am on Instagram as the Kenyan CEO. That's where I'm mostly active. I am on other platforms. I admittedly don't nurture them as much as I should. But if you start with the Kenyan CEO on Instagram, you can find a link there to schedule time with me to chat. That's the best place.
Kenyan CEO. I like that. I like that. And you like pay it forward, it sounds like, to chat. Like you have time to talk to people. And I mean, you had time for me, so I'm grateful. Thank you.
I time has always been very elusive for me. But I like to make the time to have meaningful conversations that will create an impact. I do just ask that whenever I spend the time talking to people, that you have one takeaway from that conversation and take action just for yourself. So it's meaningful.
That's nice. You know, get some level of like accountability. Like, hey, I want to give you time and I'm going to give you these jewels.
Yeah.
Like take some level of action.
Yeah.
That's key. That's key.
Yeah.
So, I mean, eventually you may have a family, you do all this, like, man, do you imagine how you can juggle all of that?
Yep.
You already got it laid out in your mind.
I definitely know that my mom, you know, she traveled with us when we were really young. So I would like to be able to show my kids the world as well. I travel very with intention when I'm going to different places. I'm always looking at how other families are doing it, what families around me are doing, and also just having a nanny or some help around me most of the time. So while I'm here recording, somebody's pacifying my baby out in the hallway and things like that.
Oh, okay, good, good. Having a nanny, that's rich folks talk right there. I mean, I hire a cleaner for my house. I feel like cleaning up my house, even though I'll make up my bed by myself and my own laundry. But like that's like stuff that's taking me away from my business. So I'd rather have someone clean. I'm working on getting my chef and, you know, focus on building my legacy and my empire as well. But I see you're on a fast track and like you're inspiring to me. I'm sure you're inspiring to others. And we definitely want to stay in touch with you and see where it goes.
Yeah.
The Kenyan CEO is where you can find her on Instagram. Yeah. Follow her, ask questions. Don't be shy. Don't be afraid to step out on what you feel like is your destiny. Yeah. I don't know what made you feel like that was like your calling. If you got like something that whispered to you late at night or
money,
it's just money. There we go. Money motivation. Hey, sweet. Cause money brings freedom.
Yeah.
And again, like I always say, control your money. Don't let it control you. Mm-hmm. I mean, I know you like your high fashion and I guess you kind of balance it, but you know, I don't see you as like overspending to the point where you can't make investments because you got too much Gucci in the closet.
Absolutely not.
Good, good. I tell people, get an asset that can pay for your Gucci.
Yeah.
You know, don't pay out of what you do. So perfect, perfect. Well, hey, man, I thank everybody for coming and listening to the show. Diane, I appreciate you. It's a pleasure. I always learn when I talk to you. And for you all listening to Boss Up with Mr. Key, you can find us on any platform. Like, comment, subscribe. If you love it, tell us. If you hate it, tell us. Whatever, just tell us something. And until next time, do what you need to do to be you.